In this video tutorial, we are going to learn about Azure Virtual Machine, and which is part of infrastructure as a service from Microsoft Azure. We will quickly learn some important concept first, because I believe those are very important for better understanding. Then we will log into the Azure portal to configure Linux virtual machines, and then we'll configure a virtual machine. And after this it is ready, we will log in and we'll try to make it as a web server, so we can have a trial of a mini website, and then we can see the functionality of the Azure portal as well. So let's begin, guys. Let's go and log into the Azure portal. So this is my Azure portal. If you look at it, this is left hand side, you'll find these tiles where you can find all the services: home, dashboard, etc. Let's click on home, and here you can find the very frequently used or favorite services here. And if you want to create a resource, you can click here as well, or you can go to home, because we are going to create a virtual machine. You can create a click on virtual machine and this will start a wizard. Otherwise you can scroll down on the left hand side pane and you can click here as well. Okay, I'm gonna create a virtual machines here. Now if you have previously created any virtual machines, it would be visible here, but there is nothing from in our account, so there is nothing visible. So I'll go and create one quickly. So this will start a wizard kind of a console. So let's see. Now first we need to provide our project details, but before we start, guys, Azure has two different deployment mode or deployment strategies. One is classic and the other one is resource manager. By default, if you are going to start creating a resource, it would be adopting your resource manager mode for creating creation of that resource. But if for certain reasons you want to go for a classic mode, you can come and click here. So let's first, you need to select your subscription. I'm currently using a free trial, so I'll be selecting that one. You need to select a resource group. So your resource group is nothing but kind of a container which would be keeping your resources together, and that those resources can be managed all together. Like they can delete it together, you can put policies across those resources. It's like if you want to manage certain servers together as a part of a project, those can be clubbed together here. So this is what your resource group will achieve for you. So let's see if we have something. So let's create a new one quickly. So the one would be bcg_demo. This is the group I'm going to use. Click OK. Now it will ask you to provide a virtual machine name. So guys, you need to pay attention here. The virtual machine name would be utilized at two different places. First of all, a name at Azure portal or Azure console, and the same name would be used as a computer name or the host name for your virtual machine. The one which is used as a computer name or host name on the machine, you can log in and change that one, but you cannot change the one which is going to be used by Azure portal or the dashboard. So let's provide a name which can be utilized later, or which should be good enough. What should be the name here? Let me say first VM. That's okay. So first VM, I'm putting it as a first VM. Then it will ask for the reason. So reason is the location basically where you're going to host or launch your virtual machine. Currently I'm selecting is East US. There's a drop down you can see here, and you can check whatever location is convenient for you, or wherever location you want your virtual machine to run in. Accordingly, you can select your location. Currently, Azure claims that it has got 54 regions across 140 countries. So one, you can choose one as per your convenience. So I'm going to select East US. Then you need to select availability options. Now availability options is like what kind of a redundancy you want to keep for this virtual machines. So what are the options we have? We have availability zone and availability set. This is a single virtual machine, so I'm not going to create any redundancy for this one. But if you need, you can select either availability zone or availability set. So I'm going to select no redundancy required. Then we need to select which image. So image is the operating system which would be copied from this image to your virtual machine. So we need to select one operating system which you think would be you want to run. In this scenario, I'm going to select CentOS based 7.5. So I'm going to select that one. After that, you need to select the size of your virtual machine. So these are the different sizes available. If you want and you think that this size is not good enough for your virtual machine, you can always click change size and you will get other options available. So you can see these are my virtual machine sizes. These are the offering, these are the family, and this is the virtual CPU and the quantity of RAM which each size supports. How many data disk it supports, what would be the max IOPS for that particular size options, how much would be the temporary storage, whether the premium disk available or not, and what would be the monthly cost. So accordingly you can select. So as I said, we would be going for B2MS standard, so I'm okay with that. Now your Linux machine can either have a password based authentication for the logging, or it can have an SSH public key. For this particular demonstration, we'll have a password based authentication. So we'll put a username first. So this would be my username, and I'm putting a password here which is complex enough to match all the criteria. Let me retype the password. Now you need to select inbound port rules. So you need to select here which ports on which ports your virtual machine would be accessible from the public internet. So if you want that it should not be visible to anyone, you can select none. Otherwise, you need to select allow certain ports here if you want that communication to happen. So as I said initially, this is a Linux machine and we have a plan to make it a web server. So we'll go and select HTTP, HTTPS and SSH. Now this is a little warning which say that these ports will be exposed to the internet. We know that, we are okay with that. Let's go and click disk. Now it has got OS disk types. So guys, if you click here, you will have three different options. One is standard HDD, then we have standard SSD, and then we have premium SSD. This is your magnetic hard disk, and these two are your solid state drives. And they have got better IOPS and better input output for your read and write operations. And accordingly, you can select. So I'm going to select premium SSD. My selected size do not allow me to select an ultra disk. There are certain VM sizes and regions where you will have ultra disk compatibility available, which is not there in this case. So we'll leave it as it is. Then we have an option to attach our data disk. So this is operating system disk and this is for the data disk. Currently I'm not attaching any other disk on this one, so we'll just leave it as it is. Let's click on advanced. We are going to use manage disk, and this is the recommendation from Azure that as far as possible we should be using manage disk by Azure. Those disks would be managed by Azure, so there would be no maintenance overhead. And now a new options have been started appearing here that is called ephemeral OS disk. So currently this is not supported for instance size. Basically these are the temporary storage which we have. After the disk configuration, let's move to network configuration. So here we can define what would be the virtual network. By default it takes the resource group name and add a VNet to this and create a virtual network for us. If you want, you can create a customized one for you, but for this demonstration we are going to stick with the default network. This is the subnet range which has been created for me. So what does it mean? That whatever virtual machine I'm going to create, it would be part of this particular subnet, and the internal IP would be aligned or assigned from this particular range. Then it says it shows us the public IP which would be assigned to our virtual machine, and this is with the name of my virtual machine and dash IP over there. If you want that this machine should not have a public IP, you can select none. Then you have NIC security network security groups. So in Azure you can apply security groups or network security groups at two different levels, one at a subnet level and then another one is a NIC level. So this is something which you can define whether you want at a subnet level or whether you want at a NIC level. So NIC level would be very explicit. This is the public inbound ports which you selected previously, and it shows here. We will stick with that. Then accelerated networking. So we are not going to select accelerated networking because that is not being supported by the size which I have selected. Currently, I'm not going to select any load balancing because this is a single virtual machine which I'm going to run. Else, you can click here and you can see your load balancer. If you have already created, it will start showing here. So we are not going to do that. Next, let's move to management. Then we have certain management options, whether we want to have boot diagnostics. We don't want to do that because that would require a storage account to be created. Or you can have OS guest diagnostics. Currently, I'm not going to go and enable any kind of a diagnostics. Then we have system assigned managed identity. This is very important, guys. What happens if you don't want to save or code your credentials in your application, then you can utilize Azure system assigned managed identities. So there is no need of coding the credentials. Your system will assign a managed identity and it will take care of its life cycle as well. So that's what you can do, but we're not going to use it now. Auto shutdown is a very important feature. If you enable it after so and so time, whatever time you mention here, that would be at that point of time your virtual machine would be auto shutdown. And if you want, you can have a notification before shutdown at the email which you specify, but we're not going to do that, so we'll make it off. Now you can also opt for backup. If you want to enable backup for this virtual machine, you can make it on, and accordingly this you will get a options here where you can create a vault, because you need a vault to be created for that particular backup to happen. You need to select that resource group, as well as you need to have a backup policy. We'll talk about this backup in a different tutorial, so I'm gonna switch it off as well. So next, move to the advanced options. Now we have extensions. So this is a post deployment configuration for automation. You would find a lot of third party extensions which can be installed along with when your virtual machine starts configured after the launch. This is a post launch configuration happens. These are the different agents you'll find, the extensions which you can select. If you want to have, like, you might have a chef agent, you might want a cloud workload protection, you want some kind of a custom script or control amp. So you can select from here, and after your machine is ready, those extensions would be automatically installed. I don't want to do that, so let's this one. There are certain virtual machines basically from the Linux platform which utilize cloud in it to install packages and write files for your users to configure and security. But particular this image does not support cloud init, but there are a lot of virtual machines which they support cloud init. It's like kind of a providing a boot script or a startup script. Then there's a new option which you will see now, that Azure allows you to run this virtual machine on a dedicated host. So that dedicated host will be a physical server on which this particular machine would run. Azure will take care of its maintenance and everything, and you will have a guarantee that your particular virtual machine will go to a specific physical server. So for that to happen, you need to create a host group, and that host group would contain your subscribed physical host or physical servers. And then you can select it from this place, and then your virtual machine will going to run or to be launched on that particular physical host. But we do not have a dedicated host at this point of time, but this would be a very good option if you have some kind of a compliance issue where you are already carrying some kind of licenses from like Oracle, SQL, etc. You can utilize which are hardware bound basically. For those kind of an option, you can use this host or host group. Then we have now we started seeing that VM generation option. So you can either have a generation one, that is a previous generation, this is by default selected, and then we have generation two. Generation two will have a lot of new features, like it has got UEFI based boot architecture, while your generation one would used to have a BIOS based boot architecture. in which in generation 2 will found if you will find increased memory and operating disk size limits. In generation 1 you can have around 2 TB of operating disk size, while for generation 2 you can have much more than that. But currently there are a lot of features which are not supported or were supported by generation 2, such as your VM backup, Azure site recovery. All these things are still not available with generation 2. It's kind of a preview available. So we're not going to select that, and let's move to the next one, tags. This is kind of a labeling your virtual machine, which would be helpful when you start receiving your bills. You can find out which department or which machine has what kind of a cost assigned to it. But let's leave it as it is now. Let's go next, review and create. Here it will have a final validation, and once the final validation is done, you will see the summary of the input which you have provided, and it will also show you the per hour approximate cost here. And then you can go back and you can again scroll down and check the options which you have defined here, and if you are okay with that, you can just go and create it. So it will start creating the virtual machines for us. So it will take some time. In the meantime, let me pause the video and come back. So guys, our deployment is complete. You can see that. So let's go to resources. So here you can see the different parameters. So this is an overview of the resources which we have created. So you can see the size here. You can see the public IP address which my machine has received. This is the private IP address. And if you see, it's from the same subnet range which I was showing at the beginning when I started configuring the virtual machines. Then here you can see the activity log, what are the activities happening on this virtual machine. So currently it's only created or updated, and here you can see the networking, all those port we opened. This is the disk. So this is my OS disk. This is 30 GB premium SSD, no encryption. This is the sizing of my virtual machine. And if you want, you can change your sizing here, but always keep in mind that change of the size will cause it to be restarted. Then all these options you can check it from here. Now let's go and see how to log into our virtual machine. So let's go to home. This is my virtual machines, and this is my first virtual machine. So what we can do is, this is, let's open it and click on the public IP address. Let's copy the public IP address, and we would this, because this is a Linux box, so we need to use PuTTY to log into this machine. So I'll go and paste my IP address here, the public IP address, and I'll open it. So it'll ask me to, yes, I'll go and log in. This was my username, and if I remember it correctly, this was my password. Hopefully I remember it. Okay. Yeah, so see, we have logged in. So let me maximize it for you guys, and let's see the host name which I was trying to show you. You can see the same host name has been taken by the virtual machine which we gave at that point of time. So now the virtual machine is ready. Now let's do a quick run of installing web server on it and see how does it work. So first let's update this virtual machine. Okay, I need to become root. So this is how it is. Let me apply the password, and now we can update this virtual machine first. So it will start updating now. Okay, so it was always a good practice to update your machine. So I have updated my Linux box. All updates have been installed and verified. So now let's install Apache or HTTP server on this one. So yum install httpd. So this is going to install httpd service on my virtual machine, the Linux box. So and after that, we would be configuring a mini website for our trial. So let's see. Let's start httpd service. Okay, it's taking a bit of time. Okay, service httpd start should work now. So started. Let's make sure that if it restarts, my server or my http service should be running. So check config httpd on, that make sure that whenever my system restarts, the web server should restart along with the machine. Now let's go to the cd var www.html. Let's go to HTML directory and create an index.html. So I'll use nano for this one. You can use either vi editor or anything else with which you're comfortable with. index.html. So let's create a small HTML file here quickly. So this is my HTML file, HTML. Let's me mix bit of give me a bit of color style is equal to background color colon, let's make it to Matthew. That should do it, I believe. So let's put a heading here. Which one? Let's give it a bit of, you know, make it give the color as well. Let's make it blue color. I think it should be, no, it's not correct. There's a mistake here. It should be good enough. That's my MS. Let's put a button as well, so it gives a bit of website look to you guys. So let's see. Okay, so let's click me. Hopefully everything goes well. Hopefully it goes. So let me see. So I think it should be pretty okay. Close the codes. Let's go through the code. This is background. I think it looks okay to me. Okay, let's save it. Control X would save it. Say yes. So I'll say yes. Enter. It has been saved. Now let's go back to our web browser and see whether it works or not. Before that, from the browser itself, we need to get the public IP once again. So this is my public IP, and if I go and put it here, so let's paste it here, enter. See, so this is my mini website which we just made it for you guys, and it's perfectly working. So that was the demonstration regarding the virtual machines in Azure. Hope you like it. If you have any feedback about it, please make sure you put it in comment. Thanks for watching, guys.